somebody you've probably all seen here up a few times, had a great deal out in Merritt Island, Charles Fischer.
All right, good evening, everybody. Doing well tonight? I'm doing good. You'll see why in just a few minutes here. So how many people here stay away from frame houses? You guys have heard me before. I love frame houses. How many people in here love termites? I love termites. You'll see why. People often ask me where I come up with my deals. This house I actually purchased from a couple that I met for the first time at a Halloween party that we threw at the house for our kids. My oldest daughter, who was actually in kindergarten at the time, she graduates from UCF on Saturday, if that gives you any idea of the time frame. It was 2002 that I met this couple, like I said, at the Halloween party, and I just casually explained what I do. I had a full-time job at that particular point in life, but I was a real estate investor, and I'd already made that commitment that I was a real estate investor, and explained to them that I bought, you know, ugly, unwanted, damaged houses. So fast forward, what, about 15 years, and my phone rings. This is another key for me, is that anytime I meet somebody, I put their name and their phone number right here. Just about all of them, because my memory's not always that good. So, you know, I wasn't really close friends with these folks, but I would see them from time to time. Their kids were in school with my kids for a while. But then the phone rang, and it was his wife calling and said, "Hey, Charles, I know that you buy houses that are damaged. We've got quite a problem here. We're looking for someone to help solve it," which those are the words we want to hear, right? So what had happened is they had bought this house about 5 years ago. They lived in it. They got a transfer up to Virginia, put it on the market retail to sell it, had it under contract for, I think, about $320,000, $325,000. This was right at Christmas 2 years ago. They were getting ready for the inspection. They were moving their stuff out of the house. She moved some things out of one of the closets, and she thought there was a little black mark on the wall. She went to scrape it off, and the drywall collapsed. And then she started peeling back and peeling back until you see what's there on the right-hand side. Hopefully you can see that. That is what was the master walk-in closet, completely eaten back all the way through the studs to the exterior of the house. So over the next year, while they lived in Virginia, they were dealing with insurance company, attorneys, and pest control companies, because believe it or not, they had a bond on this house all the way through from the time they bought it until the time they found this damage. So they called me and said, "You know, Charles, we got a settlement letter from the insurance company. We just want out. We've been flying back and forth dealing with attorneys and all this different stuff. We're just sick of the house. We don't want to see it anymore. We want to get rid of it." Again, that's a motivated seller, right? So we talked about the numbers, and I was very honest with them. I told them what my profit level needed to be. They also had quotes from contractors for about $80,000 to $90,000. They didn't tell me that. I looked at the house and I said, "I bet your contractor was close to six figures." And she said, "Yeah, it was right about 90 grand." I said, "Exactly, because, you know, we get used to estimating these. That's at retail." So here we are. We settled at 170. And after repaired value was, again, 330. And then estimated at the time was about 55, which is what we knew we could do the work for. It didn't need a roof. It didn't really need a kitchen. It just had a lot of termite damage. Thankfully, the termites were not into the trusses. They weren't into the top plate. It was mostly, I say superficial, but very, very, it was horrible to look at, obviously, when the walls are collapsing throughout about a third of the house. So we went in and, you know, gutted all of that, put in all new, a lot of new drywall, painted the place, and we did bathrooms as well when we were in there, which I think is the next picture. So there's the after and the master bathroom. The good news is this house is only about 2 miles from my home on South Merritt Island, so our commute time back and forth to the job site was very, very minimal. And that's one thing I know somebody asked Jennifer earlier, how much time did she have into the deal? As a guy flipping houses, that's something that's very important to me as well. I like to track the amount of time. And in this house, I'm in under 70 hours. I go to the job site, meet with the contractors, make sure things are looking good, and I hand over checks and I get out. If I hang out too long, I distract the contractors. They're there to work and get the job done. So here's how it really worked out. We wound up selling it at 359, and the market changed a little bit, but remember I'd said it was under contract at 325, but that's before the bathrooms had been remodeled. We went in and did a few extras. We did list it originally at 389 because that's what some of the comps were showing. But one thing we've noticed in this market, maybe it's happening here in Orlando, but definitely in our market, it's not increasing at the rate that it has been for the last couple years. Now, we went under contract on this property in November of 2017, and we closed May of this year, so right at 6 months we were in the deal. But we went out at 389, we had several showings that first week. People raved about the house, but we didn't get any offers. The house next door went on the market at 369 with a pool, very nice, but we made a decision that we needed to get under that house as far as the market value was. Again, what was my ARV to start with? 330, right? We were at 389, and you can see where our numbers came out. I said, let's get this house priced properly. We dropped it $30,000. I know that's a big jump, right? But within a day, we had it under contract, and less than 30 days later, it was closed, and you can see the profit that was waiting for me. That house next door sat on the market for 90 days. It just closed a couple weeks ago. So, you know, that's a lesson I've learned over the years, is if you price it wrong because you're going for the stars, be able to react quickly, get it to where it needs to be, get your money, get in, get out. And, you know, that's where we are. Any questions?
I do, actually. The rehab, you have it at $55,000. How much of that was fixing the termite damage, and how much was it? I know you said you did the bathrooms. Did you have to do the kitchens as well, or what else did you have to do?
No, we did not have to do the kitchen in this house. We cleaned it up. We put new knobs on the cabinets. We kept the granite. We did steam clean the tile. All the rest of the flooring we replaced. It's a 2,400-square-foot house, so we did a little upgraded flooring. We did have to gut 3 bathrooms, 2.5 baths. Okay. And the master was an extensive renovation. If you look at the picture of the bathroom before, it was amazing to me in a house at the $300,000 price range that it had a bathroom like it did. You walked in, and there was a toilet right in the middle of the bathroom. It had a corner, 30-inch corner shower, and then this jet tub just, like, stuck in the corner. And it was just very, very poorly laid out. And that was the biggest expense. So I think about $20,000 or so was with all of the framing and the drywall repair. The rest of it was just normal renovation.
Now, with it being wood frame, did you have to do anything to the outside of the house, or were you able to just take the boards out from the inside?
Well, actually, we got very lucky. We were able to keep the entire exterior of it. It was all stucco, and that we were able to salvage all of it. We were able to cut the wood, what was left of it, away, basically with a sawzall, pulled all that out, redid it, and then we had to patch the stucco from the outside, but we didn't have to replace, I mean, maybe 8 or 10 square foot of stucco in one or two spots. The rest of it was just patching. Pretty incredible. We had planned for more, but we got lucky.
All right. We have a question over here.
I just got a question.
Yes.
Did you have to get any of that permitted?
You do have to get work like this permitted. Again, we got very lucky because none of it was structural. And we had, from the owners, gave us copies of all the reports that they had. They had an engineered schematic of where the damage was. They had all kinds of reports on the bug damage and the structural damage, but the fact that it was not structural damage. So that report was very helpful. You know, yes, and again, that we can have that topic or that discussion for hours, but you can't really do, in my opinion, from what I've seen, owner-builder, if you're buying the house to renovate it and flip it. If you're going to live there, you can do owner-builder, but you can't if you're going to flip it. You can try. I wouldn't suggest it. I have a great GC. I met him about 15 years ago. He's also a member of CFRI, mostly works in Brevard County. But find a good general contractor who is investor-friendly and understands the business.
Yeah. Got a question, Bruce?
The house was bonded. Does the owner get to keep the insurance money?
Yes, the owner got the insurance claim, and that's why they settled with us at 170. They did take a small loss versus getting the work done and then selling at retail, but to them, they were living in Virginia. They had no desire to deal with the house. It was a huge pain point for them. They kept the... They kept that settlement, took the 170, and took off.
Todd?
Were there active termites?
No. By the time we got there, they had been, you know, they were completely annihilated. I mean, they had people from University of Florida there, entomologists or something, doing studies, because they had attorneys. I mean, this was all attorneys back and forth. So they were dead. Now, in an abundance of caution, we had my termite guy come in after we did all the demo. He visually looked at the entire place when it was opened up. And then when it was done, he came back out, reinspected it, and we did sell it with a bond through his company, just in an abundance of caution. Plus, every piece of wood we replaced was pressure treated. It doesn't call for that. All the studs, everything pressure treated. So 100 years from now, the only part of that house that might be standing is the part that we renovated, because it's all pressure treated. We in that case, I wanted to over-engineer it. And another point, we did disclose. I do a disclosure on all the properties we sell, because all the properties we sell retail, they go on the MLS. So we do fill out a property disclosure, and we disclosed that there was termite damage and that it was repaired. Absolutely, I'm not doing that. Over 250 transactions, I can't afford one of them to come back because I didn't disclose what had happened to the house.
Absolutely. Yes, ma'am.
Actually, I use a private lender who I met through CFRI, and the way I structure my transactions is I generally borrow the purchase money, so we borrowed 170. I fund my renovations out of my pocket. That gives me a chance to do many projects at one time. You know, we're doing 5, 6, 7 flips at a time. We use private lender money for a first mortgage position, only one person, and we're paying 12%, so you can calculate that. It was about $1,700 a month. For 6 months is $10,200 or something like that. That's where that number came from.
Rosh?
Yeah, did you do like fumigation for the termites, like roof tanking?
Well, there's two different kinds of termites, right? You've got subterranean, which come under the ground, and then you've got dry wood. They do sometimes tent for dry wood. These were subterranean, which is generally treated with a chemical either sprayed on the surface or injected into or under the slab. Which that's what they did after they found these. They drilled, and you could still see all the holes where they injected it under the slab as well.
Any other questions? Yes, sir.
I'm sorry, I came in a little bit late. How did you source the transaction?
This was actually the parents of a kid that went to school with my daughters back in 2002. So I met them 15 or so years ago. Didn't really keep too much in touch with them. Our kids went to different schools about 5 years ago, so just would see them every once in a while. But again, I had, you know, embedded in their brain that I'm the We Buy Houses guy. And when they got into a bind, didn't want to go traditional retail sale, I was the first person they called.
So, like, personal branding?
Well, I guess you could say personal branding, just being known in my local market to be that guy that buys ugly houses.
Yeah, and that's the thing I always tell everybody. If you're in this business, tell everybody who you are and what you do, because you never know who's going to have a situation that they need help getting out of. And this is a perfect situation. Just having a conversation, telling them what he did. Sure enough, 15 years later,
there you go.
Took a little while, but he got a deal out of it.
You just don't know where the deals are going to come from, right? I never knew they were going to be a $100,000 customer for me, but it worked out that way.
Any other questions? All right. Thank you very
much,
Charles.
Thank you, Charles.
That was a great deal. Thank you.